Time circuits on. I wrote the letter on September 1st, so we'll send you back the very next day, September 2nd. That's a Wednesday, September 2nd, 1885, 8 a.m. I get shot on Monday the 7th, so you have 5 days to locate me. According to my letter, I'm a blacksmith, so I probably have a shop somewhere.
All you have to do is drive the time vehicle directly toward that screen, accelerating 88 miles an hour.
Wait a minute, Doc. If I drive straight towards the screen, I'm going to crash into those Indians.
Marty, you're not thinking fourth dimensionally. They'll instantly be transported to 1885, and those Indians won't even be there.
Right.
Well, good luck for both of our sakes. See you in the future.
You mean the past?
Exactly.
Celebrate year three, it's Marchy McFly again. Back to the Future 3, a month-long podcast with me. It's Marchy McFly, it's Marchy McFly again. I'm doing it again. I couldn't stay away, I confess. Another adventure with Marty and Doc, and this time they're in the OS. So come along with me, celebrate year three. It's Marchy McFly again. Stay here all month long and get sick of this song, 'cause it's Marchy McFly, it's Marchy McFly again. It's a 31-day podcast where I celebrate one movie, and the movie happens to be Back to the Future Part 3.
Diddy-da-da-da-doo-da-boo-beep-a-doo-boo. Hello, Back to the Future fans, and welcome to Marchy McFly Day 15. Can you believe it? Now, I'd like to say that we're halfway there. The end of this episode, or the beginning of this episode. Wait a minute. No. The end of this episode would be the halfway point. Oh, my goodness. Oh, geez. I thought today was the halfway point in the middle of this episode. But that, okay, if you took half of 14 and a half, that would only get you to 29. Oh, my goodness. It's not until half of tomorrow's episode that we're halfway there. I can't do math. I was all excited to say we've reached the halfway point. When we reach the halfway point of this episode. But that's a lie. That is a bold-faced lie. So instead, tomorrow we will have reached, or we will reach, the halfway point when we're halfway there. Living under stairs. That's the first thing I could think of. I don't know. But welcome back, everybody. As I said already, it's day 15. It's March 15th, which means today, for the 15th time in a row, I watched Back to the Future Part 3, and for today, for the 15th day in a row, I am here discussing Back to the Future Part 3. Now, I wanted to discuss two things today, first of which is the Pohachi Drive-In. That is the name of the drive-in. And I remember seeing it's called the Pohachi Drive-In. How do they even know that? And then realizing, oh, there's a sign in the background right away. You see, like, they don't hide it right there, called the Pohachi Drive-In. The Pohachi
is my understanding, based on this, the novelization, the Pohachi is the Native American tribe that we see in Hill Valley being brutally chased down by the cavalry. They almost run into a time machine and a young teenage boy, but they're never named in the movie as Pohachi. The drive-in is called Pohachi, so that led the author of Back to the Future Part 3, Craig Shaw Gardner, to call the people the Pohachis. In the book, it actually says, there's a line that says, Marty recognized those clothes and designs from his high school Hill Valley history classes. It was the local Indian tribe, at least local in 1885, the Pohachis. And all 100 of them were headed straight for him. What do you say in times like this? Indians! So that is he does say that in the movie. The only difference is in the book, when he sees the cavalry, I think he says, oh no, in the book, instead of saying, shit, the cavalry. That actually, in the movie, I wanted to talk about this multiple times. Every time I see it, I go, oh, I need to mention it. That scene, Marty talks to himself at least 4 times in a row. He goes, I think I said this already, didn't I? But I don't care. He says, Indians! Oh, shit! The cave! He sees the cave. Now, in the book, it says he drives off a ledge. Then he has to push the car into the cave. When you watch the movie, it almost looks like the car is about to go off a ledge. So I wonder if they originally were going to do that, but instead changed it up to just have him back into the cave. A cave! And then he says, then he says the cavalry. Then he says, must have ripped a fuel line. I forget the exact line. And then he screams at the bear and runs for his life. But it just seems like in a row, he says multiple things to no one there. But look, if anyone, you know, saw me walking around, there's plenty of times where I'm talking to myself and I'm not holding a recorder or podcasting. I'm just a kook talking to himself. Not a noted kook like certain people, just a kook. I've said before, I wish we got more of the Native Americans in this movie. They could have, but at the same time, I was thinking about this. Maybe it's better off they didn't, because I don't know if they would have handled it with, you know, quite well. It might have been a little cliched. So it might have been better off that they just had it for a moment, had it as kind of a joke that, you know, the drive-in is named after and themed after the Indian tribe, the Native American tribe. So, of course, the whole joke is, you know, you're not thinking fourth dimensionally. When you travel back in time, you'll go to 1885 and those Indians won't even be there. And, of course, when he goes to 1885, there's a group of Indians right there charging right at him. So that's really the joke. And that's their only kind of use in the rest of this movie. They don't come up again and again. Probably better. I think maybe we got reference of Injun, because the Nikkei, is that some Injun talk on Marty's Nike shoes? But not really much else other than that. I've talked about in the past at the drive-in, the two movie posters on the wall. This was from that What Culture video where he says, the guy mentions that those two posters were movies starring Clint Eastwood before he was like an unknown extra in those movies. But I noticed after knowing that fact, you notice Marty kind of motion to those two posters. Like he almost points at him. He's like, oh, that's right. You don't even know who he is yet. But what I want to talk about is in the background. So it's November 1955, and the movies playing in the background that'll be showing at the drive-in that are on the marquee, there are three movies listed. Francis in the Navy, Ma and Pa Kettle at Waikiki, and Abbott and Costello Meet the Mummy. Now, Abbott and Costello, to me, is the most famous of the movie. I know they meet Frankenstein, they meet the mummy. Ma and Pa Kettle, I knew as a concept, like, oh, I thought that was like what you called old people. Oh, it's old Ma and Pa Kettle, but they were actually named after characters. I didn't even know Ma and Pa Kettle. Ma and Pa Kettle are comic film characters of the successful film series of the same name, produced, by, of course, by Universal Studios in the 40s and the 50s, played by the same people. Phoebe Ma Kettle and, Marjorie Maine and Percy Kilbride were Ma and Pa Kettle. And they made 9 movies. So they have 2 more movies after this before, I don't know, whatever happened. They're old, so maybe, you know, the worst. But Ma and Pa Kettle at Waikiki is a 1955 American film. I said this already. 7th installment. And it came out in April of 1955. And yet, in November, it was showing at the drive-in theater. Is that, you know, that seems weird that a movie, but who knows, maybe movies played a lot longer then. I don't know. We also have Francis in the Navy. This, I have no idea what it is, but it's starring Donald O'Connor and Martha Hare. Francis in the Navy is a 1955 American black and white comedy from Universal, of course, produced by Stanley Rubin and directed by Arthur Lubin. So it was Rubin and Lubin. It stars film star, okay, get ready for this, Donald O'Connor and Martha Hare, and marked the first credit for the film role of Clint Eastwood. Oh my goodness gracious. So not only was Clint Eastwood in the movies featured in the posters, Revenge of the Creature and Tarantula, but he was also in Francis in the Navy. So that makes 1,000 times more sense as to why that movie was chosen for the marquee. Now, Francis in the Navy came out in August of 1955. So, okay, I mean, again, a few months before November, but you could see maybe the drive-in movies got second-run movies. So these are older. They finally get to the drive-in theater. But I feel like both of these are smaller movies if you're going to see a triple feature. And the main movie you're there to see is Abbott and Costello Meet the Mummy. Now, I don't think Clint Eastwood's in that at all. Abbott and Costello Meet the Mummy, again, another 1955 movie, directed by Charles Lamont, starring Abbott and Costello, and of course, it was produced by Universal. They call all three of them Universal International, which I guess is what it used to be called. Now it's called Universal Pictures. At one point, it was Universal Studios. I don't know what to call it. Universal Studios goes to Universal Pictures. I can't talk. But Abbott and Costello Meet the Mummy. You know Abbott and Costello, who's on first, what's on second, and Abbott, you know, they get scared, they see the mummy, all that fun stuff. And this movie came out in June 23rd of 55, so at least all three of them came out before the November date. It would have ruined me if they came out after the film's timeline of November 55. But again, you could always say, well, something changed in the timeline, even though you can't, because they never go previous to 1955. Wait a minute. Of course they go to previous 1955. They go to 1855. So something in 1855 changed the timeline to allow these movies to come out a little later, and that's why they're at the drive-in. There you go. Boom. I retconned it to make it fit. And you know what? There's only one other thing I wanted to talk about. And that is the McFly farm. I keep bringing this up. But I thought, and I like to come up with these alternative ideas. It would have been cool if in an alternative world, you know, my idea of Leah Thompson not being Maggie McFly, but actually being Maggie Baines. Okay, I've said that before. Maybe she works as a school teacher. Maybe she, is a school assistant for Clara. That's how you get her into the storyline. Or maybe you have her be the daughter of farmers, and you have both of her parents as farmers. They can be, you know, they could have returned as older versions of the Baines family. Both actors were still alive at the time. George DeCenzo was alive in 1990. He passed away in 2010. And of course, Francis Lee McCain, of such films as Gremlins, and as Back to the Future, and I know there's another one, there's a big one that I can never remember, but Frances Lee McCain, she's still McKickin', so she's still alive. So that could have been a way to bring more of the original cast into this. And I just think that would have, it would have served to make the film a little richer. Yes, seeing Marty dressed up as Seamus is fun, but again, I prefer logic sometimes over, you know, funny little stunt casting the guy as two different versions of McFly's. And I think it would have been actually kind of funny if you saw, you know, Marty fall, you know, get chased by the bear, trip over the little cliff there, the little hill, fall down, bump his head, and then this old timer comes out and says, "Stella, get over here. We got another idiot. He fell in, or we got an idiot who fell down and hit his head. Help me bring him into the barn, or help me bring him into the house." Something like that. Just could have been, you know, just could have been another callback that I think would have only served the movie better. And I had to look up, I was like, I think her name's Stella, but I had to look it up to see Frances Lee McCain's character in Back to the Future as Stella Baines. And that showed me, oh my goodness, she was also in Footloose, and she was Mrs. LaChance in Stand By Me. Jeez, I think, am I done already? I mean, I'm not sure what else to talk about today. I guess, well, I mean, I did mention today is March 15th, right?
Please be seated. Now, before we commence our services today, a local podcaster wanted to come up before the congregation to say a few words to everyone. So if you please.
Thank you, Your Honor. Your Excellency. Thank you, Father. Ladies and gentlemen, you probably don't know me. Most people don't. But I wanted to come up here before everyone today and just talk for a few minutes about today.
Yes. You know,
today is March 15th.
15th.
Okay. A lot of people call it the Ides of March. But for me, it's something very personal that I wanted to discuss today, this specific day. Mm-hmm. This day marks 50 years since the author George McFly was murdered in cold blood.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
And a lot of people say, well, Michael, that didn't happen. What are you talking about? And I'm here to say, you don't think it happened. You don't realize it happened. But I witnessed the timeline in which it did happen. Now, you may be asking yourself, why do you all of a sudden have a Southern accent? And I cannot explain it. I just think it allows me to deliver what I'm saying with more gravitas. Mm-hmm. You understand?
He does sound smart.
George McFly is a man who deserves more than he was allowed in this series of movies known as Back to the Future. Are you familiar with the Back to the Future movies?
Yes,
I'm not sure if they're allowed here. I don't know if they're considered, too racy because of all the incest. Or I should say, implied incest. It doesn't actually happen. We all know that. But George McFly, now, I know you might be thinking to yourself, Michael, it's Marchy McFly 3.
It's the wrong movie.
Let me finish. It's Marchy McFly 3. Yes, okay. But because this year marks the 50th year of George being brutally gunned down before Marty got in the time machine and went back to 1955 and got the Gray Sports Almanac back from Biff,
spoiler,
negating the entire alternative 1985 timeline, he was killed. He was killed years earlier. So in a certain timeline, to a certain people,
is he still going?
George McFly was dead from 1973 to 1989. Dead!
I wish you were.
Now I know, you might think, isn't this a movie? Well, show it is. But you might also say, well, what kind of a person would watch the same movie over and over again and podcast about it? You know, these are just things that are just unknown, okay? And you may say, Michael, you had this whole plan of doing something like you're talking in front of a church. Did you write any of it down? Did you plan what you were going to say? Clearly, that didn't happen. So even though the murder that I have so compellingly explained to you never happened in the current timeline, and in fact was part of a feature film that I discussed last year, I don't care. Okay, I don't give a shit. Sit down. Sit down. I'm not done yet. Okay, Father, get the hell away from me, Father. All right? Get the hell away from me. Now, I'm gonna finish, okay? Even though it's from last year, today, this year, today, marks the 50th anniversary.
You said that.
So, God damn it, I apologize. Whoa. Jesus, God, I apologize. Gosh damn it.
Oh, that's a little bit.
It had to be said. Okay? Now, I need to get off the stage, and I need to realize I'm not Southern, and I need to lose this accent.
Is it wrong to call someone an asshole at church?
But if you want to talk about it more, follow me on Twitter and Instagram, at Geek Mentality, okay? The Facebook page, listen up, the Facebook page is Fans Not Experts, okay? You understand? And, you know, I have a website where all these questions can be answered. That website is fansnotexperts.com. All one word, fansnotexperts.com. I'm not sure if I'm saying it very clear because clearly none of you actually visit it. That's right, you. Yes, you, Mildred, in the first row. Fans, write it down. fansnotexperts.com. All right. Now, even though I won't be here at the church tomorrow, because clearly I will not be asked back, I will be doing another podcast tomorrow. So I hope you do listen to it. I hope you subscribe. And now, you know, you can stop holding your applause. Oh, clearly, I was not reading the room correctly.
Was it just me?
Well, anyway, for those few of you who will listen tomorrow, thank you again. And hallelujah, here is my theme song.
This is my podcast, I made it. Geek Mentality's what I named it. And I think you should listen and subscribe. 'Cause I'm kinda funny and awesome. I think that I'm worth your time. And I'm kinda handsome. My mom says, please listen and please subscribe. At least listen to this episode.
Fans Not Experts.